In the last episode, I rented a server in order to build my own VPN service. The idea was to change my geolocation and possibly get access to services which are not available where I live. In this first episode of the VPN bonding series, we will use a VPN connection to a virtual server just like the one which I have rented in order to bundle multiple internet connections into one and hence possible double, triple or quadruple my internet speed. We will do this by using multiple Wi-Fi hotspots like this one, or personal hotspots from an iPhone or Android device, or of course multiple cable or DSL connections. The solution is manual for the time being, but if you are looking for an automated solution, please see my call to action at the end of this video. Like many of us, I do not see my parents that often these days. My father will soon be 80 years old, but he does have a smartphone and he is using WhatsApp. So recently, I thought, why not just give him a video call? He was actually very surprised when he saw my mug on his phone. Unfortunately, we could not have a proper conversation because of bandwidth limitations. My parents live in the countryside, so they have all the advantages of a rural environment that is space, nature, calm, good air and so on. However, when it comes to infrastructure, things are not always so great. Their internet connection, for example. I live in the city and have a 100 megabit downlink and a 40 megabit uplink. The best my parents can get over cable or DSL is 6 megabit down and 1 or 2 megabit up. That's a bit short for good video communication. You might say, why don't they just buy a faster connection? Well, the problem is that they would probably do so if they could, but there is just nobody selling these. This is hard to understand if you live in Chicago or Tokyo or Frankfurt, but it is a reality in the countryside. Now, as I am a techie, I thought, maybe there is a technical solution to this problem. My idea was to use a second and maybe a third and fourth connection and bundle them together. Either they could buy a second phone line or use a wireless 3G or even 4G connection and aggregate it with the existing line. In essence, if they can't buy a larger pipe, why not build one out of many small pipes? Checking YouTube for faster internet connection, the available videos fall into three categories. The first category that actually has the most views are prank videos that promise double speed for free. While these might have an entertaining value, they do not provide a solution, so their technical value is zero. The second category are videos that promote a paid service. Some of these videos are not even clear that if you subscribe to such a service, additional cost will incur. The service providers will obviously not give you access to their infrastructure for free. Furthermore, these services are not necessarily available everywhere, but can sometimes only be purchased in certain regions or even cities. So these do not provide any useful input neither. The third category of videos that I found deals either with a proprietary or open solution to aggregate connections, but usually they do not increase the bandwidth, but rather provide failover or resiliency solutions or just bridge connections together. That might actually give you higher bandwidth if you have many users using the internet connection or if you are doing P2P file sharing or anything similar. The reason is the way the TCP/IP protocol works. When TCP/IP was designed by the military back in the 70s, a main requirement was resiliency in a sense that if a node in the network went down, an information could still be routed over other nodes. Using multiple paths simultaneously for one connection in order to increase the bandwidth had never been an initial requirement. So if you bundle two connections together and you were, for example, watching a video over these connections, all the traffic would still go over one single line. If a second person was watching another video, that single connection could go over the second line. So the total bandwidth would be higher, but not for one single given connection. What we therefore need is a fourth way of doing things. As I have just said, just adding more internet connections to your home network would not solve the problem, as the other side, that means the server or peer that you are trying to reach in the internet, is not aware that you want to use multiple connections. That's just by design. So how can this be solved? Basically, we would need a solution that can aggregate or bond multiple connections into one, then spread the IP packets equally over the multiple connections, reassemble them somewhere in the internet where we have higher bandwidth, and bond them back together into one connection. Linux does provide such a bonding or aggregating solution. In the enterprise environment, this is frequently used to bond Ethernet connections together, for example, to provide higher speed for very busy servers. Unfortunately, we can't run Ethernet cables through the internet, but rather need to rely on the infrastructure the providers give us. However, with Linux you can also bond other interface types. For example, let's have a look at OpenVPN, which is a free VPN solution that, by the way, many VPN providers use internally, even if their product has a different name. OpenVPN can provide us with two adapter types for a connection. One is called TUN, like for tunnel, and the other one is called TAP, like formerly used for terminal access points, mainly with dial-up modems. The TUN devices operate on OSI level 3, that means they provide an end-to-end network device over IP, while the TAP devices are quite similar to Ethernet devices. In other words, we can use Linux bonding mechanisms on OpenVPN TAP devices and achieve our goal to bundle multiple connections into one to a given VPN server in the internet. Like always, you can download the scripts to implement this solution from my GitHub repository. The link is, like always, in the description of this video. So what do we need to build this? We need a Linux machine at home. That can be a Raspberry Pi or a virtual machine running in VMware, VirtualBox, Fusion or Hyper-V, or it can be a router with an open firmware such as OpenWRT or DDWRT or Tomato. Second, we need a server in a data center with a high-speed internet connection, for example a vServer or VPS that you can rent from $1 per month up like I did in my last video. On the software side, we need OpenVPN as a VPN solution and a couple of tools that are mainly used to make installation easier. The scripts install this automatically for you. Let's start on the server. I'm logging into the server using SSH. The first thing I do is install Git because I want to download the scripts from my repository. All I have to do is type apt install git and then git clone and the URL of the repository, which you can find on my GitHub page. This downloads the scripts. Of course, you could also just zip them together or transfer them from your workstation to the server using WinSCP or FileZilla. Now let's cd into the server directory and check the configuration parameters. By default, the script uses two connections, but you can use virtually as many as you want it. Just change the parameter in the provided config file. If you are happy with the values, just launch install.sh. This script does a couple of things. It installs the necessary software and provides a start and stop script for the bonding tunnel. It sets up multiple OpenVPN instances depending on how many connections you want to use. The first tunnel will be available on UDP port 1191, the second on 1192, and so on. It does not change your firewall settings, so you might need to open these ports on the VPS firewall. Furthermore, it generates a secret key that can be used by a client to connect to the VPN. Please be aware that this is not the perfect way of using OpenVPN, it's just the easiest. The goal of this video is not to lock down OpenVPN, but rather to explain channel bonding. Perfect, this is all we need to do on the server. Let's now move over to the client. Same procedure, check the config file. You need, of course, to specify the same number of tunnels here, like on the server. Also, you need to tell the script which interfaces you want to bond. In my case, this is WLAN 0 and WLAN 1, but you may choose any interface, be it Ethernet or PPP or wireless or a 3G or 4G dongle. Last but not least, the client needs to know the name or address of the server. I have added this server into my hosts file and called it my VPN server, but you could also specify the IP address directly. Great. Once we are happy with all the values, then we just launch the install script, and again, this does everything for us, such as install the software, configure the VPN, and copy the scripts for bonding. The interfaces that you are bonding together do not necessarily need to be up at this point. One last thing that we need to do before we can launch it, that we need to copy the secret ta.key file from the server to the client, so that the client is authenticated to connect to the VPN server. The server installation script has printed out that key at the end of the installation, so you could easily copy-paste it over to the client. So far so good. We have a server with two TAP interfaces and we have a client with two TAP interfaces. Now let's start the machine. First thing we do is launch the start bond script on the server. This actually launches the OpenVPN server on two instances, bonds the tab interfaces and also adds a masquerading rule to IP tables so that we can, for example, surf the internet from the client. Next, of course, we need to start the bond on the client machine. Note that at this point, the interfaces that you are aggregating need to be up. Running the startbond.sh script on the client starts the OpenVPN clients on the given interfaces, binds the client to the right interface, changes the routing rules on the client so that it uses two or more distinct connections to the same server, and last but not least, changes the default gateway of the system to the remote VPN endpoint on the VPS or vServer in the internet. Cool. Now let's test this. I have a bandwidth of roughly 20 megabit per Wi-Fi hotspot here. As I'm bundling two connections together that have roughly the same speed, I would expect getting approximately twice the speed now. Also, of course, the speed test should not show my own IP, but rather the IP of the data center where the VPS is located. When I ran this test for the first time, I was rather disappointed. I was expecting speed figures around 30 to 40 megabits, but what I got was this, barely 10 megabits. I instantly thought, man, it's not working. The whole days that I have spent preparing this video were a lost cause. 3 weekends for nothing. But then I started investigating. If we look at the diagram here, we can see that there are a couple of conditions that need to be fulfilled in order to give us real increase in bandwidth and speed. And guys, this is not specific to the solution that I describe here, but it's exactly the same if you buy a service. I'll show proof in a second. The first chunk of this diagram is the local connection speed. I've checked these without VPN by just enabling one interface after the other and running a speed test. Keep in mind that the speed test will always select an optimal server close to your location. Those were fine and showed roughly 20 megabits per connection. The next bit I wanted to test is the speed going out from the provider. Maybe their line is congested. So I launched a browser directly on the virtual server in the remote data center, but that showed tremendous speeds up to 300 megabits per second. Then there is the last remaining piece in the middle, which is my connection speed to the VPN server. In order to test this, I just established an SFTP connection to the VPN server and downloaded a file directly from there. This is where the bottleneck was. I just did not have a high enough speed to the VPN server in the first place. This clearly shows the limitation of this concept. And as I said before, this also happens with the paid services. This is just one example of many websites outlining problems like this. In this case, it's Speedify, but any other provider will have this problem. In essence, it is pretty much like going for a run as a group. The slowest runner needs to go first and determines the speed of the whole group. So is it a good and viable concept at all? I would say yes, it is, but you need to remain realistic about your expectations. If you can just buy a faster connection, then go that way. It's far more reliable and easy. But if you can't, and if you have really slow uplinks like 512k or 1 to 2 megabits, then this solution does provide an improvement. Alternatively, you might experiment with multiple data centers. Maybe you can find one that has much better bandwidth over the ISP you are choosing. Most VPS vendors give you a 30-day free trial, so there might be time to test this before you engage with any of these. Actually, when I did the first test, I ran it on a Sunday afternoon. That is probably the worst moment in time to do connection performance testings. Running the same test on a normal day during my lunch break yielded much better results. Here I got a speed of 16 megabits down and a not so bad 13 megabits up over one single connection. Bundling the two connections gave me a fantastic 34 megabits down and 23 megabits up. So actually twice the speed as expected. It works. We have reached a proof of concept state that you can double your internet speed by bonding two connections over a VPN. So at this point in time, I need your help. It's time for a call to action. In the next episode, I will explain the technical details of what the scripts do and how things work behind the scenes. So this is for you guys who are really interested in looking under the hood. But where should we take it from there? This is where I need your feedback. I could think of various follow-ups here. Either you say, no thanks, that's fine, I was just curious to see, I do not want to follow up. That's perfectly okay, but please leave a comment to tell me. Or we could evaluate more options, such as trying the whole thing with WireGuard rather than OpenVPN. Alternatively, a third option would be to install this on an OpenWRT router and hence have an automatic connection to the VPN bond that would be transparent. That means not require any manual scripts to be run, etc. Fourth option could be to launch a project with custom hardware and software. I could think of a Raspberry Pi maybe running on a battery pack, like I showed in my battery video, with let's say 2 or 3 3G dongles, which would give you a real mobile solution to set up high-speed internet virtually anywhere in the field. Fifth and sixth option could be to elaborate on resiliency, that is, make the connection fault tolerant if one tunnel goes down. And last but not least, maybe I could make a video on actually implementing this at my parents' home. Maybe with Yagi Uda antennas to get better reach. Please let me know in the comment section what you would want to see. Also, I would like to kindly ask you to leave a thumbs up on YouTube if you like the video, and of course, subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss out on further episodes. Dear friends, this concludes today's episode. I hope you liked it. If so, please share the video on WhatsApp, on Facebook, on Reddit, LinkedIn, and Twitter. Leave me a like and subscribe. Thanks for watching. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye for now.